Hey, Andrea J. Welcome. All right, guys, come on in. It is that time again for the Gift of Forgiveness Part 3. Welcome. Come on in. You know the rules. When you come in, say hello so that I can greet you. Give me some hearts and share with your friends and followers. Hey, Eugene, welcome. Hello, hello. Servant of God, MK, hello. Natural Relaxer, hello. Good to see you. Andrea J., thank you for inviting followers. Give me some hearts. Thank you guys for that. Come on in. Enjoy Fred Hammond while you're doing that. Oh, God, I believe. Hey, thank you. You haven't seen my new hair. That's right. Welcome, sir. Welcome, welcome. Hello, hello. Welcome. Welcome, welcome. Pastor Nicholas is on. Hello, sir. Good to see you. All right, guys, come on in. Say hey as you're coming in. Give me some hearts and share with your friends and followers. We're going to get started in about 60 seconds. Come on in. First timer. Hey, welcome. The Natural Relaxer. Welcome, welcome. Definitely first timers. I know, Andrea, right? You've been waiting on this all day. I can't wait. So you guys, come on in. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Let me know if we have any connection issues. We had some connection issues earlier today. So let me know if for some reason you can't see or hear me. Coming back again, yeah. Lord and Savior, I know is the answer. I believe. Hey, Tawana, thanks for joining. Come on in. Hey, hey. I love you, honey. Good to see you. All right. Hey, HP Love, good to see you, ma'am. Thank you for being on. All right, guys, invite your folks on. We're going to get started in just a second. Yes, indeed. Tawana, give your husband a hug for me. Tell him I miss him. Haven't seen him on here in a little bit. Yes, indeed. Invite your friends and your followers. We're going to get started in just a sec here. The Gift of Forgiveness, Part 3. It's going to be good tonight. As you're coming in, don't be a creep. Say hello. Be polite. Say hey so that I can greet you. And give me some hearts and invite your friends and followers. Thank you, the Natural Relaxer first timer. Thank you for being on and for inviting your friends and followers. Thank you for all those hearts. Look at all that love. Thank you. I appreciate that. I believe it. I believe it. Yes, I do. Sandra Watson won. Hello. First time on. Welcome. Thank you for being on. Appreciate it. You came in a good night. Hello. Hey, thank you. This is my relaxed do, actually. I've been doing my own lashes this week, so I haven't poked my eye out. Doing good, yeah? So thank you for that. I appreciate it. And this hair is big, but it's different. I figured I would try it. One of my best friends told me it's a little ethnic for me. I said, I don't know what I think about that, but okay. Hey, Veronica, good to see you, ma'am. Thank you for joining. How many of you guys were on the prayer scope this morning? Did you join the prayer scope? Did you watch that? Were you blessed by it? I thought it was powerful. If you have not seen the prayer scope, please, please go. And HB Love, you were on. Yes. Yes, indeed. WY Nance, thank you so much. Natural Action, you were on. Okay, awesome. Yeah, that was powerful. It sure was. I feel like I might do it again tomorrow. I think we need to do another prayer scope on focus. It was with me all day. It was fantastic. You got to watch the replay, Tawana. It was anointed. All right, let's get started. We usually give welcome addresses and all that stuff for the first few minutes. I think I'm going to do another one in the morning. Because there was definitely some oil on that, on the idea of the power of our focus. A decided woman, a decided man is a powerful thing. And the Holy Spirit was dealing with me. Hey, Donald, welcome. Was dealing with me this morning about the need for us to be decided and for us to focus. And a person with a singular focus is definitely ripe for the Lord to use and for him to literally shoot you out like an arrow when you are focused and when you have a singular focus and a singleness of mind. It's a powerful thing. So I think we are going to do another prayer scope on that tomorrow. So look out for that. All right. So welcome to all of you. Thank you to the first timers that are on. Hey, Pastor Juanica, good to see you, ma'am. I love you. Thank you guys for being on. All right. So listen, we're going to do this scope tonight.
It's going to be powerful. It's our third installment of the very first series I've ever done on Periscope, which I'm very excited about. And it's called The Gift of Forgiveness. The Gift of Forgiveness. If you've seen any of the other ones, let me know. If you've seen it on YouTube or if you've joined, just drop in. I was on for the first week or for the second week. Yes, when you're focused, it's hard to get distracted. That's true. Absolutely. Let me know if you were on for any of the other ones. Of course you were on, Tawana. You're part of the reason I had to get my Periscope life together. So yes, I know you were on. I posted the full teachings on YouTube, on my YouTube channel. So if you do not follow me, if you're not connected to me on YouTube, please, HB Love, the first one is on YouTube in its entirety. You can definitely go and watch that. It's Nicole DeShera, same as it is on all the other platforms. So you can feel free to go and check that out. Okay. So real quick, I was asking who was on because I didn't want to belabor things too much. I've got a lot of meat and potatoes tonight that I want to make sure to get into. And so I want to do a quick recap of week one and two. For those of you, thank you for all of those hearts. We're going to mess around and get to 300,000, guys. We're really close. We were at like 280-something, 290-something the last that I looked. So thank you, guys. Definitely show a lot of love tonight, okay? And if you have not already, please invite your followers, invite your sphere of influence so that they can be a part of this, because there's definitely some people that you know that follow you that need to hear about this. So feel free to push it to Twitter, to Facebook, to here on Periscope while we're live. You can push it to your Periscope followers. And when you're watching the replay, you can only post to Facebook and Twitter. Okay. All right. So that's the deal about the rules of engagement. You want to say hello when you come in. Don't be a creep. Say hi so that I can greet you. First timers, we shouted you out. We'll shout you out again at the end. And definitely give hearts and share with your friends and followers. Okay. So those are the rules. Questions I'm going to ask you to hold to the end. I've got a segment for Q&A. And if you were with us last week, that was anointed. The Spirit of God moved so heavily with us last week when we got to Q&A. It was fantastic. So I'm going to do that again tonight. I have a ton in my inbox of people that sent me stuff, and I cannot get to all of them. Unfortunately, I won't be able to, but I am going to pick a couple and go over those. Okay. And I'll give you a chance if you have questions to ask them and drop them in on the screen. Wasn't that powerful? Oh my goodness. Last week, Q&A was anointed. We could have skipped the rest of it and just done Q&A. It was fantastic. All right. So thank you guys that have emailed me. I appreciate that. It's been a huge response to this, and I'm really, really grateful. I know that it was God ordained that we do it at this time. So thank you guys for that. All right. And so that is the deal as it relates to rules of engagement. I'll do a recap real quick, and then we'll get right into week three. But before we do, we'll pray. Father, in Jesus' name, we give you praise and we thank you for this day that you made, and we honor you for allowing us to see it. Thank you, oh God, for a singular focus today. Hallelujah. Thank you, God, that we were more productive today than normal because we were aware of our need to focus. And thank you for the Holy Spirit that empowered us and that answered us in prayer and enabled us, oh God, to be more focused today than we've been previously. And for this, we're deeply grateful. I lift up every person watching this Periscope, those that may watch by replay and even on YouTube. I pray even for those that aren't born yet that will watch this series long, long time from now. I thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus for what you're going to do with us in this moment. And I give you praise and thanks, oh God, for it's going to be life-changing. I pray that you lead us through this moment. I pray that you lead us through this teaching and that you speak clearly that we might be able to hear you and to sense you and to know that it's you that's speaking clearly directly to us, directly to our hearts, directly to our spirits, directly to our situations. And we'll be swift to obey you as we prayed this morning, and we give you thanks and praise for this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, I have a visitor. Excuse me, guys. This is probably my youngest daughter who doesn't like to go to bed. Yes. No, bed. Good night. Don't be scared. Go to bed. Yes. Bless the Jesus. Bless the children. Never wants to go to bed. Pastor Nicholas never ever wants to go to bed. All right, let's get back to it. Okay, so the recap from week one and week two. Let's talk about that briefly. We talked a little bit, why forgiveness. That was one of the big things I wanted to make sure to address early on, why we were doing this. The reason that we chose the topic of forgiveness for the first Periscope series was just because it's something that all of us encounter. We encounter it, whether we choose to embrace that that's what it is, or that, or the fact that it's important or not. It's something that we all go through. It's something that we all have to navigate and brave in one way or the other. And it's something that when I prayed and sought the Lord and asked for just guidance and direction as to what is going to be impactful, he helped me to see that a lot of us are bound with the spirit of unforgiveness. And so that's the reason that I chose to make this the focus for the month of May, something we've done every Tuesday at 9 p.m. Eastern time, and we have one more installment, which is next week. So you want to make sure to join us for that. So we talked about the definition of forgiveness. The working definition, as we know it for the sake of this discussion, is the act of setting someone free from an obligation to you as a result of a wrong done against you. We know forgiveness to be an act of setting someone free from an obligation to you as a result of a wrong done against you. And that's really important for tonight's discussion, because we're going to get into self-forgiveness. And so I want you to hold on to that definition if this is the first time that you've heard it. We talked a little bit about what forgiveness is not, that forgiveness is not forgetting. It's not negating the impact or the difficulty associated with certain things that we experience in our lives. And so we talked about that. It's not a matter of acting as if something never took place, or acting as if it wasn't that big of a deal. We like to try and shrug things off, you know, okay, when it's really not okay. So forgiveness is not acting an act of avoidance. And one of the most important things that we discussed is that forgiveness involves three parts, that it has an act, that it involves injury. That injury can be an expectation that was failed. It can be something that was missed that we, thank you. It can be something that, my son's taking out the trash. The mommy duties, they never stop. It can be something that was missed as it relates to expectations. It can be something that was promised, over-promising and under-delivering, those sort of things. But in some way, it always begins with injury. It then goes from injury to debt resulting from an injury. And then cancellation of that debt is the actual act of forgiving someone. No, you're okay. Thank you, honey. Appreciate it. Sorry. Yeah, you could have done that a long time ago because you've been home since 2:30. But anyway, bless the teenagers. Oh, God. All right. So forgiveness, we know, has three parts. Injury, debt resulting from the injury, and cancellation of such debt. We also talked about the authentic forgiveness is not for the unbeliever. This is important. Each teaching is over an hour, so I'm not going to, a little over an hour, so I'm not going to get into, you know, recap everything. But I definitely want to make sure that you've got all the meat that you're going to need for tonight and understanding of what's happening tonight. We talked about the fact that authentic forgiveness is not for the unbeliever. Not for the unbeliever. Why is that? Because it's the Holy Spirit that assists and guides us as it relates to forgiveness. So we do not forgive from here. We do not forgive from our intellect. We do not forgive from our understanding. Because quite the contrary, your mind, thank you guys for all those hearts, your mind is going to give you 99 reasons why you should not forgive. And one of the things that many of us discovered, and I got testimonies of this in my inbox, people that have been braving this journey by way of this series that we've been doing, a lot of people discovered that that was a big roadblock for them, that unforgiveness was lodged in their soul because they'd been trying to forgive from their minds, trying to convince themselves to forgive, as opposed to enabling the power of the Holy Spirit to work through you to do it, because it certainly is a reflection of the God in us, because it is God that instituted forgiveness from the beginning. From the very beginning, he's been concerned about forgiving man, and he's been concerned about redeeming us back to himself. He's been concerned about being in right standing and in relationship with mankind. He told Adam and Eve that if you eat of this tree, that you'll surely die. And so one could argue that he could have absolutely struck them dead where they stood when they disobeyed him. He did not. We know that spiritual death, that separation from God, became a byproduct of sin as a result of what happened there. But even in God's response to their disobedience, we immediately saw from creation that he was interested in redemption. He was interested in right standing. He was interested in bringing us back into fellowship with him. And so when we think about the importance of forgiveness and the way by which we do it, it is from God. It is come from God. The desire to forgive, the ability to forgive, the willingness to stick through the process of forgiveness, all of that comes from God. So it is not for the unbeliever. All right. So then in week two, we talked a little bit about the fact that unforgiveness is actually not a word. That if you look it up in the Webster's dictionary. And you guys know when I teach, I generally like to do the anatomy of a word, the etymology of a word. Where did it come from? Where did it originate? That sort of thing. And what I did when I found, when I went to do that as it relates to unforgiveness, I discovered it is in fact not a word, that you will not find it. We know that un, the prefix un in front of any word, basically means it is not. So the idea of not forgiving actually does not exist. And we talked about the power of that last week, and the fact that that really is paramount in the reasons why we need to do it, and why not just from a spiritual but even from a natural perspective, it's foundational, it's necessary, it's urgent, because the word unforgiveness doesn't even exist, right? And we talked about what an unforgiving spirit looks like, that it isn't a grudge, that it isn't having trust issues, it isn't any of the nice packaging that we like to put around these things, enabling us to stay in our places of offense, but that it is in fact harboring a spirit of unforgiveness. There's an unforgiving spirit running rampant around us, and many of us have opened up the doors of our hearts and welcomed it in and allowed it to come in and take up residency. So we talked about why that is problematic, and we also talked about the fact that the debt created with error and with sin is something that the Lord created a way by which for us to be redeemed from, and that act and that process is something that he expects for us to emulate as it relates to our forgiveness of one another. He expects for us to look for ways to be forgiving, to be quick to forgive. And many of you, if you follow me on other social media outlets, I didn't talk about this in week two, but it hit me like a ton of bricks. The day after we did our teaching last week, it was last Wednesday, I encountered something personally that I was not expecting. And it really hit me hard. And I was talking to my best friend, who I think is on, I think I saw Yolanda join. And she was saying to me, she said, well, you know, the words that we speak are definitely going to be tested. And an area where you had previously been very vulnerable has been healed for you. So of course, the test had to come, or the confirmation of what you spoke had to come by way of something unexpected. And God knows that happened. And so you might've saw me ranting on social media on Wednesday of last week about the need to be swift to forgive. Forgive quickly. That's not something that we talked about in week two, but it is foundational for us in week three, that it is important for you to forgive quickly. I talked about the fact that when we don't forgive quickly, when we're not swift to forgive, that we block ourselves from being able to see and to sense what God is saying about what has happened to us and his directive as it relates to how to move forward. I was counseling someone this week over the weekend, and they were concerned about strategy. What do I do next? I've been hit with this devastating blow. I wasn't looking for it. I wasn't expecting it. What in the world do I do now? And like many of us, they were caught in the emotions of what was going on in the moment. And I said, to be perfectly frank, and they were even struggling with telling me about what happened. And I said, you don't have to worry about any condemnation for me. That's not my feel. And I don't have a heaven or hell to send you to. And so that's not at all where I'm coming from. That's not my goal or my role in your life. I'm very clear that my role in your life is to help you through this period. So I'm not at all going to be the person to throw condemnation or shade at you. But you do need to know that the emotion is not the focus, that you got to be willing to forgive quickly, because without it, you can't see clearly what to do next. Mm-hmm. Many of us, unforgiveness, we talked about it last week, is blinding. It is toxic bondage. That was the language that we used in week two. It's toxic bondage. It's like drinking poison and waiting for the person you're mad at to die. We all know that that is not the way it works, that the person who suffers the most is you. It is not them. Okay, so when we talked about the bondage last week, I failed to mention that the lack of swift action to forgiveness is definitely costly. If we waste a lot of time and we give up a lot of opportunities, and we can allow a lot of time and unnecessary gaps, so to speak, when we hold on to things and when we're not swift to forgive, that's very important. So let's talk about week three. Today, our focus is going to be self-forgiveness. If you can, drop that in the screen for me. Self-forgiveness. Toxic bondage. It is. Absolutely. It is toxic. It isn't just bondage. It is toxic. It is killing you softly, and you don't even realize it, but it's showing up in other areas. We said last week, it shows up in your personality, shows up in your other relationships. It's horrible. It's toxic. All right. Self-forgiveness. All right. So the working definition of self-forgiveness, I recapped week one and week two, and I gave you the definition of forgiveness for the sake of this discussion. And it's important for us to look at this this in the context of self-forgiveness because it's really powerful. The act, not just a thought, not just a desire, but an act, an action, something that we have to actually do. An act of setting someone free from an obligation to you that is a result of a wrong done against you. The act of setting someone free from an obligation to you that's a result of a wrong done against you. Now, when we put that in the context of self-forgiveness, let's do that definition again. Self-forgiveness is the act of setting yourself, not someone else, but yourself, say me, the act of setting me free from an obligation to me that is a result of a wrong done against me. Me. This is going to be good. Woo! Powerful to me already. Me. So it's the act of setting me free from an obligation to me that is a result of a wrong done against me. How powerful is that? That the idea of me forgiving myself for a debt that I owe to myself as a result of a wrong I did against myself. Now, some of you might be scratching your head. Some of you are like me, dancing on the tabletops inside, right? Because I can absolutely pinpoint several things in my life, a monument of things in my life that I struggled to where even forgiving other people and accepting the forgiveness of God wasn't so much my problem, but it was forgiving myself. It was releasing myself from the debt that I subconsciously owed to me for the wrong I did against me. Self-forgiveness. Now, how do we wrong ourselves? How do we wrong ourselves? Some of the main areas: poor choices, wasted time, a lack of self-care. These are things that we do that injure us. These are the ways in which we harm or wrong ourselves. And we create debts for ourselves and subconsciously punish ourselves for these things. And we hold ourselves hostage. I want to talk for a moment about poor choices. Poor choices. How many times have you opted to be in a relationship with someone and then later said to yourself, I don't know what I was thinking. That was the stupidest thing I have ever done. How could I be so dumb? How could I be so blind? How could I be so naive? Huh? Many of us, all of us, at one point or another have had that kind of self-talk with ourselves, right? Which is redundant, self-talk with ourselves, right? So how many times have we said, I can't believe I didn't see that coming. I can't believe that I didn't notice the writing on the wall with that. I can't believe I stayed in that as long as I did. I can't believe that I didn't choose the right thing. I knew that I should have done X, Y, Z, 1, 2, 3. I can't believe I didn't do that. These are the conversations we have with ourselves, okay? Tonight is all about you. That's why I had you to write in the screen, me. Tonight is about me. We're not going to deal at all with what other people say and do. We're going to get to them next week. That's the bill we're going to put on this whole discussion. Tonight, we're talking about you, me, right? So I've made poor choices. I've wasted time. I've neglected myself. I'm in a weight loss journey right now. And many of us, can you guys see and hear me okay? I just got a message asking if the broadcast was down. I guess it's I'm getting comments, so it must be up. I'm not sure why this other person can't get on. Okay, so there have been many times that we have... Okay, thank you. Okay, good. All right, yeah, I'm not sure what's going on. It was just one person. But anyway, we find ourselves in this spot where we are rehearsing, the ways in which we've neglected ourselves under the umbrella of self-care. I'll give a little personal testimony. I'm on a weight loss journey right now. I'm going to be sharing some more about that with you guys in coming scopes. But I'm on a weight loss journey right now, probably for the 29,000th time in my adult life, losing and finding. I have lost and found so much weight, I can't even tell you, right? I done lost and found these same pounds so many times over, it's insane. But in any case, I'm braving the journey one more again. To lose the unwanted weight, to be healthy, to bring sexy back, all the stuff we say, right? Great. So at the beginning of the journey, I remember looking in the mirror and being totally disgusted. It took me a long time to decide to go ahead and brave this journey again because I was so disappointed in myself for the fact that I had lost this weight and gained it back so many times. And specifically in 2013, yeah, 3 years ago, I lost a bunch of weight, had gotten to my ideal size. My ideal dress size was a 10-12. I got into a 10-12 and I couldn't have been happier. And then I got sick, I got divorced, and the bottom fell out of my life, and I gained all of that weight back with a few extra bonus pounds. So when I looked in the mirror to start this journey, I was devastated, and the negative self-talk I was giving to myself was, how could you let this happen again? How could you end up here again? You've done this before. You've been down this road before. How in the world could you find yourself here again? And to be honest, that is one example, but we all have many, where we've not taken care of ourselves, where we have neglected us, where we have neglected, and that causes, that's an injury, and that causes a debt, because then, you know, I had to forgive myself before I could start the journey to losing weight again. Because mentally, and I'm an emotional eater, so that was a horrible cycle. Because then I would look in the mirror, I couldn't fit my clothes. It was a cycle every day. I'd get up, I only had a few outfits that I could actually fit. And at first, I had all this stuff. I eventually boxed it all and put it away. But I had a bunch of outfits that I wanted to wear. And every morning, I would go in my closet and look at them and be disgusted that I couldn't fit into them. Refusing to go out and buy more clothes in bigger sizes because that was horrible. You know, fitting rooms are not your friend when you're not the weight that you want to be. And so I refused to do that. And I found myself completely disgusted. And every day that emotion would spawn eating. So I'm going to Starbucks. I'm going to get the biggest drink with extra caramel on the top and the bottom that I can enjoy. Frappuccino, probably. And I'm going to get myself a warmed butter croissant while I'm there and pack on some extra pounds because I'm just sad about, I'm a sugar junkie. So it's always got to be something sweet. Maybe I'll get a what are they? Blueberry yogurt muffins. Love those things. And I would do that. And that was my cycle. And the negative self-talk was insane every day. That is a demonstration of a lack of self-forgiveness based on poor choices, wasted time, lack of self-care, and the results of all these things. Because all of the things I mentioned, they have babies. And so all of the babies of the things that I mentioned before, they all led me to a place of beating myself up negatively every day. Nobody else had to tell me that I needed to lose weight because every single day I hated to walk by the mirror. I hated to look at pictures of myself. I'm the selfie queen. I love the camera. I hated the camera, or it was only from here up, nothing else. And my face tells on me because my face is fat anyway. So when I gain weight, I gain it in my face too. So that was terrible. Then I'm like, well, I need to grow my hair back because my face is all fat and my hair is all short. It makes it look fatter. It was terrible. So we create these debts with ourselves and we subconsciously punish ourselves for the things that we're upset about. And we hold ourselves hostage. We talked, I think it was in week one, about how the fruit of the spirit is tied to forgiveness. And how when we don't forgive, we cannot be spirit led. That we have to take our cues from our flesh. You remember that? We have to take our cues from our flesh when we allow unforgiveness to reside in our souls, because there is no way for God to have a free flow and for us to be able to clearly hear his voice when we are allowing unforgiveness to stay. And so we talked about how we don't exemplify the fruit of the spirit to others. And we know the fruit of the spirit based on Galatians 5 and 22 to be joy, love, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. And we know that against such there is no law, according to Galatians 5, 22 and 23. And we talked about how you can't exemplify love to somebody if you're unwilling to forgive them. You can't exemplify joy towards someone because you're unwilling to forgive them. So what we do is we end up holding hostage the fruit of the spirit, we hold it away from people that we don't forgive. And the same is true as it relates to how we treat ourselves. So you're not loving with yourself. You're not patient with yourself. You're not long-suffering with yourself. You don't have goodness toward yourself. You have no peace within. You are a nervous wreck. You don't have a whole lot of faith in your abilities to do, to be, to have. All of these things, we hold hostage the fruit of the spirit away from ourselves. Whew. And what's so dangerous about this self component is that that a lot of it is subconscious. We don't even realize we're doing it. That's what's so dangerous about this, that we don't even realize that we are mistreating ourselves. We don't even realize that we are withholding the goodness of God from us. And then we wonder why we can't have functional relationships with other people. Because look at how you treat you. The in-store self. It blinked on me for a second, so I wonder if I'm freezing. Let me know if I'm freezing. Thank you for sharing on Facebook. So it's impossible for me to have a healthy relationship. With unhealthy people. You cannot have healthy relationships with unhealthy people. And the same is true that you cannot have healthy relationships if you are not healthy. So I'm hearing that I'm frozen. Let me know if it clears up in a second. It blinked on me for a minute. So usually if it's freezing, it's blinking. Let me know if I'm good. Can you see and hear me okay? I can see hearts, but I don't see any comments. I may have to go out and come back in. It's clear now? Okay, good. Okay, awesome. Thank you. So it's impossible for me to have good relationships with other people when I'm not well. But the same is true with me. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. So many of you are trying to love people, but you don't love you. Many of us don't love us. And one of the things that stands in the way of loving us is forgiving us. Forgiving us. Forgiving us. The ability to forgive yourself is deeply tied to loving yourself. And your ability to love others is tied to loving yourself. Impossible for me to give to you. I was having a conversation with someone I love the other day, and we were talking about a statement that someone had made to them, and they were saying, you know, that this person that was talking to them said, you know, I feel like my man should be my everything. I feel like, you know, my man should see me as his everything, and even in the context of a marriage, you know, my husband should be my everything, my wife should be my everything. We were talking about how absolutely ludicrous that is, because the truth of the matter is, first of all, that's too much weight for you to put on any one person. It's not biblical at all for us to put that kind of weight on another person, even in a marriage. The idea for two half people or two fragmented people to come together and quote unquote complete each other. You complete me. You're my everything. Sounds great in love songs. That does not sound great in real life. Because it absolutely is a pressure that no human being is designed to carry. And so the idea of us being able to love others is deeply tied to us loving ourselves, but even our expectations of other people, which absolutely is connected to forgiveness. A lot of us struggle to forgive, and the place of injury begins with expectation. Many of us don't have godly expectations in our relationships. We expect things from people that they're not capable of giving to us. We expect things from people that they're not equipped to give to us. We're looking for people to fill the God place in us that He created and hollowed out for Himself that He will not allow anyone else to fill. A lot of us right now are praying for mates, and we praying for a boo thing because we think that's the end all. No, I don't think so. You can get your hands on the right man or the right woman today and still be miserable. And inevitably end up making that person miserable, or take what should be a blessing to your life and turn it into a curse because you don't know how to handle it. Whew. How many of us have asked God for things that we're not ready to handle? Think about it. The same conversation I was having the other day. And I said, think about it from this perspective. How in the world, if you've never known a functional relationship, your mom and daddy weren't together, or your mama beat your daddy, or your mama left your daddy, or your daddy beat your mama, or whatever the case may be, right? And you've never known functional. You spent your whole life looking for the love you didn't have in your formative years, in your foundational relationships, in your parental relationships. And so you bounce from one relationship to the next. And you don't stay in one place long enough to be able to figure out what's right or what's wrong with it. And so you've left little pieces of you all over the place. And now you've come into the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, and you're praying, Lord, send me the right man to make me whole. No, 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 no. First and foremost, because without wholeness in Christ, you're no good to any relationship. You're going to take all these little pieces of you, scoop them up, and take them to this poor man or this poor woman and say, here, take this and fix it. Fix it? I didn't break it. I don't know what's wrong with it. I'm not, that's above my pay grade. I can't even do that. I don't even know what that even looks like, because that's not their place. And not to say that meaningful relationships are not healing, because they are. They absolutely are. But it is to say that there is something desperately wrong with many of our expectations. And so the forgiveness that we need to extend isn't just for how people have wronged us. It's for you. Some of you need to apologize to people for what you expected of them. Huh? Some of y'all need to get off this Periscope when this is over and call somebody, text somebody, and say, I'm sorry for putting the weight of my life on your back. Some of y'all need to go in the other room right now and ask your wife for forgiveness. Ask your husband, please forgive me, because I expected something from you that you couldn't give me. And so how does all this tie into self and tie into self-forgiveness? Because ultimately, when we refuse to forgive ourselves, we end up looking, because man was made to worship. We're not meant to walk around with all these voids. So even when we don't realize we are, inevitably we end up trying to find things to fill them. And so when we don't look for God to fill the places in us that only He's designed to fill, then inevitably we end up attaching ourselves to this person and that person, looking for them or this thing, not even people. Some of us do it to work. Some of us are validated by our titles at church. Lord have mercy, don't get me started on people and how many of us are tripping on whether or not we're licensed, whether or not we're ordained, how many members we got in our church, how many followers we got on Periscope, how many hearts we got, how many likes our posts get on Twitter, and how many people are retweeting what we say, because we've refused to deal with the ugly nastiness that's in our hearts, most of which begins with a lack of self-forgiveness and self-love that actually is turned into self-hatred. And so then we look for all these external things to make us feel better about ourselves. Mm-mm. And what's very sad about that is that none of those things, you could run into a person, I'm experiencing this right now, that you could run into the right thing at the wrong time, and that time be wrong because of your immaturity, because of your unhealed wounds, and turn what is meant for you, who is anointed for you, and take it and turn it into a tragedy because you are not well. You are not whole. You do not love you. You do not have a healthy perspective on you. You do not have a right relationship with the Father. You are not able to love and to stay connected to other people in a healthy way, largely because there's a lack of forgiveness. Is it possible to forgive someone and to believe that God, to forgive ourselves, to forgive someone else, and to believe that God has forgiven us, but still have a sense of unrest? Absolutely, because you've not forgiven yourself. Many of us are dealing with spirits of torment and unrest. You can't sleep at night, and you're still rehearsing certain things. And many of us are thinking it's a matter of not forgiving other people, when in fact, it isn't that at all. Some of you have in fact forgiven, but I was trying to figure out what to talk about or what angle to discuss tonight. I originally had a different plan, and the Holy Spirit showed me, no, we need to deal with this self-forgiveness issue, because many of them, through this journey, they're braving this journey, and they're taking it seriously, and I'm dealing with them, and it's working, and God has even been dealing with me. I testified to that a little while ago. It's been amazing. But what's the hold up? So if I've accepted the forgiveness of God that is not merit-based, that by the way, I cannot earn. Many of us, you know, when we get a hold of that, we're really free. When you get a hold of the idea that you can't earn God's forgiveness, that you don't, that it's not something that you can do by works or by merit. It doesn't work that way. And so when we think about the idea of receiving His forgiveness and then even forgiving other people, what then is the hold up? For some of us, it's forgiveness of yourself. Forgiveness begins with what God did for us. It has nothing to do with our feelings. What does that mean? That isn't it wonderful to know that you can be forgiven even if you don't feel forgiven? My apostle said something to me, Apostle Yolanda Stith, said something to me that was powerful earlier this week. I was sharing with her just how going through this journey with us as a family here on Periscope, I've experienced some things in my own life that have come to affirm and to test even what I have said. And she said to me that forgiveness is an act of your will that emotions eventually align with. Whew. I said, wow, that's powerful. Forgiveness is an act of your will that your emotions eventually align with. So when we talk about forgiving ourselves, it's important for us to know that even though I may not necessarily feel forgiven, even though I might still be rehearsing, I might still be struggling, I might still be lamenting, we said in the beginning of the scope, struggling with just how in the world did I let this happen? Isn't that powerful? Yeah, she's amazing. Love that woman. It's powerful to think, I'm struggling with this. How in the world do I get to this place of forgiveness? But then to realize that even though I might still feel the effects, I still looked in the mirror every day for a long time struggling with, I look like this. I have gained this amount of weight. no getting around it, right? And even though that still existed, once I forgave myself and actually started the journey to change what I was seeing in the mirror, then even though the change is slow, it isn't currently happening overnight. When I realized, okay, I have decided to forgive myself for everything that led to this point. And now I'm moving forward with getting to the place that I want to be. And so when she made that statement to me, that forgiveness is an act of your will that your emotions eventually align with, it gave language to what I was experiencing even in my weight loss journey. That eventually my emotions lined up. But I had to first make the decision. From a biblical perspective, we have a couple of examples of people that likely struggled with forgiveness. Peter, who walked with Jesus, but then turned around and denied even knowing him. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine being the one that said, oh, no, I love you. I won't deny you. I'd never do that. You know, being quick-tempered and you defending him and everything, only to turn around and say you didn't know him. Paul, who before his conversion persecuted the church. Can you say what you said again? Trying to write it down. Sorry. The quote you mean probably from Apostle Yolanda, that forgiveness is an act of your will that your emotions eventually align with. Somebody can drop that on the screen for those taking notes. Thank you. Forgiveness is an act of your will that your emotions eventually align with. So Paul, who before his conversion, persecuted the church. Let's not even talk about how you have to work through other people and there and getting through your past, you know, working through that with other folks, right? A lot of us, before we even get to what people think about us, we struggle with what we think about us. And so we have biblical support. And although there isn't scripture to say, you know, this person struggled with forgiving themselves, you can imagine that in order for them to embrace the fullness of their purpose, especially Paul, there had to be, as a part of that conversion, there had to be coming face to face with and coming to a place of acceptance and forgiveness of what he had done before. And how powerful is that? That the idea of conversion and that the idea of the rebirth of us, that being born again. Jesus told Nicodemus that you must be born again. That it isn't enough for you to just, that works won't do it. And that it isn't enough for you to think about it. But that you must be born again. And so the idea of being born again is comprised of that. Much like Paul when he dealt with his conversion. That many of us need to be converted. Many of us are saved and we're not born again. And so we're still holding ourselves hostage to what we did, to who we used to be. But the assurance that we can find in God's word is that we serve a forgiving Father. How do we know? Psalm 103, verses 10 through 14. I love the New King James version of this verse. And it says, he has not dealt with us according to our sins. This is God. He has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor punished us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are as high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. As a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear him. For he knows our frame and remembers that we are dust. That's Psalm 103, 10 through 14. I think I saw my apostle join. I was just quoting you. Psalm 103, verses 10 through 14. Drop that in the screen for those that are taking notes. Psalm 103, verses 10 through 14. This is our assurance that we serve a forgiving Father. And thank you for that. And the idea that we can release ourselves from debt because we serve a God who is forgiving in nature. He who has dealt with us, who has not dealt with us according to our sins or punished us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his mercy toward those who fear him. And as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. As a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear him. For he knows our frame. He remembers that we are dust. It's important for us to know, though, that we do play a part, that it's not, you know, that self-forgiveness, you know, we talked about what forgiveness is. We also talked about what forgiveness is not. Self-forgiveness is not sweeping under the rug what we did. Nothing more hurtful when you're trying to forgive someone than running into them using self-forgiveness as a way to avoid their culpability. And we're going to get into that next week in more detail. But we know that real forgiveness of other people does not require their buy-in. It's something that you do with the aid of the Holy Spirit within yourself. So if they're not sorry, you can still forgive them. But it's difficult when you're trying to do that and you run into somebody that, you know, in the name of self-forgiveness, they act like what they did was no big deal. Or like, you know, I'm over that. I'm not talking about that anymore. I'm done with that. I've forgiven myself. And the Lord has forgiven me too, so I'm moving on. That's terrible. And self-forgiveness is not... It's not acting as if what you did wasn't problematic. There is an aspect of accountability that comes with self-forgiveness. How do we know? Because James 5 and 16 says that we have to confess your trespasses one to another. Pray for one another that you may be healed. The effectual fervent prayers of righteous people availeth much. 1 John 1 and 9 says that if we confess our sins, that he's faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from unrighteousness. So self-forgiveness does not mean that we don't have a part to play. We still got to confess, both to God and to others. Not to everybody. You don't need to get on Periscope and do a Periscope confession. But you do need to have somebody in your life that knows your story. Somebody that you can be truthful and transparent with. And when we talk about being able to forgive other people, a lot of that is also comprised of us accepting our part in the situation. John 5 and 6, it says to confess your faults one to another, that you might be healed, and pray for one another that you might be healed. So James 5 and 16. So confession to one another and prayer for one another that you might be healed is in James 5 and 16. Confessing our sins to the Lord and knowing that he's faithful to forgive us and to cleanse us from unrighteousness is 1 John 1 and 9. So James 5 and 16 and 1 John 1 and 9. Thank you for dropping that on the screen. Okay, so important for us to know that we're not the self-forgiveness is not acting as if your stuff don't stink. You're welcome. It's not acting as if what you did wasn't problematic. It's not acting as if, when we get into forgiving other people, one of the things that makes that process easier is when you accept the part that you played in it. Yep. And sometimes we think, I didn't do nothing to deserve that. I was good to them. I was kind to them. I was genuine with them. I kept it 100 with them. And they turned around and betrayed me. They turned around and lied on me. They turned around and mishandled me. And the truth is that it is possible for you to feel like you did everything right and still have a part to play. I share a lot of testimonies in these, and I've heard that that's helping people. So I'll share this one. In my divorce, one of the things that helped me to forgive my ex-husband for the things that he did in our marriage that contributed to the end of it was recognizing that I contributed too. And one of the hardest but most liberating conversations we ever had was when I called him on the phone and I said, I am sorry for the things I did that contributed to where we ended up. Huh? You wanna talk about a humble pie? Honey, that was more than a slice. That was the whole thing. That was the whole frozen section of all the pies that they sell in the market. But it was liberating. It was liberating. Do you hear me? Some chains were broken off of my life in that conversation. And it had nothing to do with his response. It had nothing to do. I went in knowing he may be accepting, he may be forgiving, he may, you know, depending upon how the wind is blowing today, he may or may not respond favorably. But the purpose of this is not for him. It's for me. Right, the entire one. Do you hear me? But it was powerful. It was liberating to be able to say, I was wrong. And I'm sorry. Not making excuses. You know, I wouldn't have had to act like that if you hadn't have done what you did. I wouldn't have had to go off like that if you had just been nicer. No, I'm sorry. And it came from a place of recognizing. I remember I was driving in the car and it just hit me. The Holy Spirit said to me, you aren't kind. And he gave me specific examples. He brought, I mean, years ago, stuff that was long ago that I wasn't even thinking about. And I was just like, wow. Look back and not go back. Yes, absolutely. And that's the power of forgiveness. And I also had to forgive myself. I had to say to myself, it is okay that you weren't the best wife you could have been. It is okay that you weren't the best mom you could have been. It's okay that you weren't the best friend that you could have been. It's okay that you didn't do everything right. It's okay that some things you were selfish, some things you were immature, some things you walked in a spirit of offense. So you were so offendable that if the wind blew hard, you were offended. I had to be able to admit that to myself and say, that's okay. Self, you are forgiven. So as we get ready to close, I'm gonna do a little Q&A and then we're gonna get into prayer. It's okay. Some of us need to say that because a lack of self-forgiveness produces uncertainty. It produces us not trusting our own judgment. It produces a sense of unworthiness. We begin to make more bad choices because we don't feel like we're worthy. Hey, hello. Because we don't feel like we're worthy of better, because we don't feel like we're deserving. And so subconsciously we question any good thing that comes our way because we don't really think we deserve it. You fail in one relationship, so when the next person comes along and they're kind to you and they see good in you, you downplay it. You know, excessive behavior, people that overcompensate. We've all met those people that are just extra. And it's like, you have a neon flashing sign on your forehead that says, I am broken, I am wounded, I don't love myself. Because you're trying so hard, clearly, you're overcompensating. Excessive behavior. Wow, forgiveness, it's powerful. Thank you for joining. False humility, we've all met those people. Those people that, you know, well, glory goes to God. And that's just this fake. Why is it fake? Because the truth is they haven't forgiven themselves. And so they don't really believe that they're worthy of God operating in them and using them. Glory to God. Oh, it was the Lord, it wasn't me. And it's false humility. And the reason it's false is because if you haven't forgiven yourself, then you don't really believe that you're worthy of God using you. I'm also a side comedian, by the way. If the rest of my ventures don't work out, I have a career in comedy. The other one is self-deprivation. We deprive ourselves. We talked about that in the beginning. We deprive ourselves of the good things that the Lord wants us to have. Jesus came, he said, I came that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. And so many of us deprive ourselves of the things that we should have and that God desires for us to have because we don't forgive ourselves. And we talked a little while ago about the fact that without forgiveness, there can't be love. There can't be. Can't love yourself and hold yourself hostage to mistakes you made, to bad decisions you made, to time you wasted, to ignorance you operated in. It's impossible. So all of those are byproducts as it relates to self-forgiveness. So tonight, many of us need to look in the mirror when this scope is over, and say, I forgive you. And be specific. I forgive you for mistakes made, And I almost don't like the word mistakes because I feel like it's overused and misapplied. I forgive you for bad choices. Because anything you did more than once wasn't a mistake, it was a choice. So I forgive you for willfully engaging in things that you knew were beneath you. I forgive you for casting your pearls before swine. I forgive you for using people to fill God's spaces. I forgive you for not being a good friend. I forgive you for being so broken that you couldn't appreciate the good things and the good people in your life. I forgive you for expecting your kids and your husband and your wife to be to you what only God can be to you. I forgive you for not seeing yourself as God sees you. I forgive you for not seeing yourself as God sees you. That's big. And many of us need to get off this periscope tonight and do that. And then ask the Lord, I want to see me the way you do. I want to love me like you do. Because when we get that right, then it makes the other relationships that we're trying to brave a lot easier. Because you won't be so quick to align yourselves with the wrong people when you love yourself. And when you see yourself the way God does. And forgiving other people isn't so hard when you've forgiven yourself. It's difficult to release others when you're holding yourself hostage. So many of us need to get in the mirror tonight and forgive. I want to do Q&A, but I really feel led to pray. So let's do that. Father, in Jesus' name, we give you praise and we thank you for this moment. I thank you, God, even right now for the sobriety and the calming spirit of the Lord that I sense in this periscope. I thank you, Father, for opening the eyes of our understanding to the ways in which forgiveness of ourselves is a direct reflection of our love, of the love that you've shown to us and our acceptance of that love. I pray, Father, in the name of Jesus, for every person watching, for those that will watch by replay, for those that will watch on YouTube, for those that will watch at some other point. I pray, God, in the name of Jesus, that you empower them to forgive themselves. I pray that the spirit of condemnation be lifted. I pray that the spirit of rehearsal of past decisions. I pray for that person that had an abortion that won't forgive themselves, that rehearses what that child would have been, who they would have looked like, what their name could have been, what gender they would have been. I pray, Father, that they forgive themselves tonight. I pray for that person who's struggling with having made poor relational choices. I pray for that person that struggles to look in the eyes of their children and see your love and your joy because they're beating themselves up for having a baby with such a horrible person, with such an absent father, with such a terrible mother, whatever the case may be. I pray, Father, that you help them to know that they are forgiven. We don't have to pray for your forgiveness because you've already given it. And so I pray that they freely accept it and that you empower them to forgive themselves, to turn that same energy, that same love, that same unrelenting pursuit of us that you have had for mankind since the beginning. I pray that they are empowered tonight to turn that to themselves, to literally hold it up like a mirror, to be able to see themselves as you do. I pray for that person who's struggling in divorce, who's on the brink of divorce, who's struggling in a bad marriage, who's struggling in an unfulfilled relationship. I lift them up to you tonight. And I pray that tonight you'd help them to turn a mirror on themselves. I pray that they no longer focus on the offense of the other person. I pray that they release their spouses from whatever they did, whatever they didn't do. And I pray that tonight be the beginning of self-evaluation, of self-reflection. David said, "Search me, O God, and know me. If there's anything in me that isn't like you, if there's anything in me that's contrary to you, that's adverse to who you've called me to be, we lift it up to you tonight, Father. And we ask you by the mighty name of Jesus to empower us to forgive ourselves, to empower us to release ourselves from the self-imposed bondage come from debts that we feel that we owe ourselves. I thank you, Father, for enlightenment in your word. Thank you that according to your word, you know that we're dust. You remember our frame. And for those that fear you, you separate us as far from our sin as the heavens are from the earth. And as far as the east is from the west, according to your word, you remember our sin no more. And so we confess it to you tonight. And we ask you, God, in the name of Jesus, to empower us to be free. We pray that freedom come to your children tonight. by the aid of the Holy Spirit, and that we no longer walk in self-imposed bondage, but that we're free by your Spirit. In the name of Jesus, amen. Hallelujah. I normally, I love intercession. And this is different for me, because normally we'd get way in there and we'd stay for a while. But I really feel the Lord calling us to a personal moment with him. And so I want to ask you, as you're getting off of this scope, to take a moment before you rush to the next thing, or even to bed, because it's bedtime now. I pray that you take a moment. Take a moment just to really embrace. Whew, feel your presence, Father, so strong. I pray that you take a moment to really embrace the forgiveness of God. I pray that you take a moment to really embrace the fact that he's forgiven you, and the fact that that nature of forgiveness, the nature of love and of kindness and of redemption, that same spirit is in us. And so it's my prayer that you just take a moment to really reflect. I'm going to leave this song up, I Will Trust, by Fred Heyman. And if you want to stay on and just meditate on that for a moment, you can. I'm going to turn the camera around so you don't have to look at my face. But I pray that you'll just take a moment in sobriety to hear God, because I feel him calling us to a moment individually. And he's so big and he's so God that we can all do it at the same time, and he can hear us all the same. So I love you. Thank you for being on. I'm going to let this play for a moment. You can continue to give hearts if you'd like. And take a moment to embrace. Hallelujah. Take a moment to forgive yourself. Take a moment to look yourself in the mirror and release yourself from what you can't change, from what you can't do over, from what you can't restart, from what you can't redo. But as I often say, you can reset. So I admonish you to take this moment with God. I love you. We'll be back together next week.
Ooh.
strong tower, strong tower, righteous running, and we're safe, safe, safe. Trust in you, trust in the name of the Lord, trust in the name of the Lord, Lord, I will trust in you. Ooh. Thank you, Father.